the head of Russia's Wagner mercenary group speaking out 2 days after leading an aborted mutiny. Yevgeny Prigozhin says he did not intend to overthrow the government. He adds he only wanted to register a protest about the ineffectual conduct of the conflict in Ukraine. Russian President Vladimir Putin also issuing his first public comments since Saturday, thanking the mercenary commanders and soldiers for standing down. He vowed to honor his promise to allow the fighters to either relocate to Belarus, sign a contract with Russia's defense ministry, or return to their families. Also on Monday, Putin met with heads of Russian security services, including Defense Minister Sergei Shoigu. One of Prigozhin's principal demands had been that Shoigu be sacked, along with Russia's top general.
A seeming calm has returned to Moscow after Wagner mercenaries turned back short of the capital. But as this report tells us, the brief rebellion now has the Kremlin fighting to salvage Putin's image.
Wagner mercenary troops occupied the southern Russian city of Rostov-on-Don on Saturday for about 12 hours, encountering little resistance as they seized the local military headquarters. Now, after an agreement with the Kremlin, they will return to their bases in the territory that Russia occupies in Ukraine, with promises of no retribution. The group's leader, Yevgeny Prigozhin, is going into exile in Belarus under the auspices of President Alexander Lukashenko, a Putin ally. The Wagner mutiny threatened the Russian capital and prompted harsh words from Putin against its perpetrators in an address to the nation.
What we're facing is exactly internal betrayal. Extraordinary ambitions and personal interests led to treason. Treason of their own country and people, and of the case that fighters of Wagner were dying for alongside our soldiers.
Russian officials have flooded the media with assurances that Putin emerged stronger from this short crisis. But international observers say, on the contrary, the Russian leader's weaknesses have been irreversibly exposed.
This destroys the myth that Putin had cultivated so hard of being completely in control and having a firm grip on power throughout the country. That is plainly no longer the case. And the Prigozhin incident sets an extremely dangerous precedent for power in Russia. Once other people see that this can be done and it can be survived, there will be other challenges.
Now, the Russian authorities are working to cover up the tracks of the Wagner Group, which until last week was praised by Kremlin propaganda. Prigozhin has challenged Moscow's narrative. Speaking of the precarious situation of the Russian army in Ukraine, one of the reasons why, Prigozhin says, he launched the mutiny.
We have daily losses of up to 1,000 people. This includes those killed, those missing, and those injured, and those who are refusing, who don't want to fight, not because they are cowards, but because they have no choice, no weapons supplies, no command structure.
Observers believe that whatever deal Putin has made with Prigozhin, a dark future awaits the mercenary leader.
Whatever happens for the rest of his life, he'll be a man looking over his shoulder, because he will now be a marked man. He has challenged power in Russia and so far survived. The question is, for how long?
Calm has returned, at least for the moment, to the streets in Russia. But after the acute crisis last weekend, analysts say the events of the last few days may be a precursor to something bigger. For the VOA Moscow Bureau, Jonathan Speer, VOA News.
Ukraine says its forces have retaken control of another southeastern village, the latest gain since it began a counteroffensive against Russian forces. Rivnopil appears to be the ninth recaptured by Ukraine this month. A spokesperson says the village is deserted and heavily damaged, adding the southern military sector had advanced 1.5 kilometers in the direction of Melitopol in the Zaporizhia region. Russia, which still holds swathes of territory in the east and south, did not immediately comment on events in Rivnopil. Let's find out what stories our North America Bureau is pursuing right now with Bureau Chief TJ Manatok.
Good morning, Mike and Nikki. Here are the latest stories making the headlines amongst the Filipino community.
We begin with millions of members of the LGBTQ community and their allies taking part in this year's Pride celebrations in several major cities like New York, San Francisco, Seattle, and Chicago over the weekend. But amid the festivities, they say the fight continues for equality, as there have been increasing efforts from Republican leaders to restrict LGBTQ rights. The American Civil Liberties Union has tracked close to 500 anti-LGBTQ bills in the 2023 state legislatures, a record high for the last century. There's also been a GOP-led push to limit drag in at least 15 states in the last few months. And in Florida, this year, education officials extended Governor Ron DeSantis' 2022 initiative limiting LGBTQ discussions in schools through the third grade, also known as the Don't Say Gay Bill, to now cover all public school grades. Gina Palpalato, who goes to Pride celebrations in San Francisco every year, says the community needs to stay focused on speaking up and taking action.
It is very important to be here, especially now, because we are celebrating the LGBT rights, and especially the marginalized LGBT people in Florida and other states. So we have to raise awareness and show that we are people of love and love wins.
In sports, Filipino fighter Jade Bornea fell short in his quest for a world title, suffering a bloody TKO loss to Argentina's Fernando Martinez. Still, the 28-year-old Bornea showed some grit against the IBF super flyweight champion in an action-packed fight. In the ninth round, Martinez hit Bornea with a solid left, causing blood to pour out of his ear. While Bornea tried to continue fighting, referee Charlie Fitch called the bout 29 seconds into the 11th round. After the fight, Bornea explained that he felt the first eight rounds were fairly even, but the ear injury had changed the momentum of the fight. After this second straight successful title defense, Martinez says he now hopes to land a title unification match. In the undercard action, former IBF Superfly champion Gerwin Ancajas scored a fifth-round TKO over Colombian Wilner Soto. Ancajas, who is fighting two weight divisions above his previous campaign, landed multiple body shots throughout the early rounds before a combination dropped Soto in the fourth round. Three straight right hooks to the body forced Soto to his knee, bringing the fight to an end in the fifth round.
Jungle did this because this can't be all you.
Y'all don't like it?
And finally, in entertainment news, we get to know film actor Martin Martinez. Martinez grew up in Northern California, where he started his performing career in theater. He starred with Wednesday star Jenna Ortega in the 2018 movie Saving Flora, and has appeared in several other projects. He is currently in Primo, the coming-of-age comedy series that's praised by critics as one of the best new shows of the year. Martinez says that as a Filipino-Latino American, he felt at home with the show's emphasis on family.
My mom is a first-generation immigrant from the Philippines, and she made it like very, it was important for us to always visit our Lola and Lolo at our aunt's and uncle's house. And so my siblings and I would spend a lot of time there, and that's where I was really immersed in the culture and the food, and everything always revolved around a lot of food.
The 22-year-old actor is also part of the hit series Magnum P.I.
And those are the top stories amongst the Filipino community in North America. You can catch more of our stories online at news.abs-cbn.com/tfcnews and on the ABS-CBN News YouTube channel. Back to Mike and Nikki for the rundown.